Around the world, hundreds of millions of women and girls remain second-class citizens, beholden for life to a male relative. What are the consequences of this for prosperity and peace, and what can and should the U.S. do in promoting reforms? To discuss all of this, I'm joined today by Melanne Verveer, Secretary Clinton's Ambassador-at-Large for Global Women's Issues. Ambassador Verveer, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.
When you look around the world today, what are some of the greatest challenges facing women? What are the things you're most concerned about?
Well, I think if we look at where women stand, we've made a great deal of progress over the years, but there are still pockets that really need a lot more attention that have huge payoffs for all of society. One is women's economic participation. It isn't what it could be. There are obstacles women confront, whether they want to start a business, grow a business, the obstacles they face in terms of management and leadership, or just as employees in terms of the kinds of jobs they're able to procure. And if you look at all of the data today about women's progress, where women are making the least progress is in political empowerment, in holding a point of office or running for elections, being able to run in the first place and then succeeding in that. There's still tremendous discrimination against women.
Let me follow up on that. Only 17% of America's Congress are women. Does that put us in an awkward place? I mean, we're 78th on the list of women in politics at the national level. We're behind the United Arab Emirates. We're behind Iraq. We're tied with Turkmenistan. Is there a hypocrisy or a danger in us trying to promote this agenda when we don't have our own house in order, or would you phrase it differently?
Well, I think we are part of the world, so we have to do better as well. We are doing better by some measurements, certainly not in the Congress. As you said, we are at 17%. We ought to be much better than that. You know, it is not anything but a fact that half the population, or even more than half in some places, is holding, you know, a fifth of all the positions in parliaments. And the United States needs to get its numbers up as well.
The Texas legislature is taking steps that are going to result in 130,000 women having reduced access to reproductive health. There's the Blunt Amendment going through Congress that is similarly anti-contraception and anti-abortion. Is access to reproductive health an essential part of the women's rights movement globally?
Well, as I said, with respect to how many women we have in our Congress, we confront issues at home, and we have to work them through our own political process. But family planning is one of the best public health interventions that can be made. It makes such a difference in a woman's life for her to be able to have the wherewithal, the family planning contraceptives available so that she can decide the size and the spacing of her children. It is about her health. It is about her future. It is about the betterment of her family. And where it has become available in ways in which women want to utilize it, they're there. They know it. It is so important to the quality of life for them. So certainly in societies, there are those who say, well, there's no place for this. But I think we all know this is a sound public health tool. It is one we support. It is part of the global health initiative that the United States has been supporting. It brings down the numbers of abortions around the world. And it is just unfathomable that women can't get the access that they need so that they can have healthier lives, healthier families, and be able to do a great deal more for their families, for their communities, and for themselves because they're deprived of it. So we need to be making every effort to make it more available.
Ambassador Verveer, thank you so much for being here.